Okay, hi, this is Al Brown. I'm doing a makeup recording for our class on Wednesday. This past week, the video didn't capture, and so I'm doing this makeup recording for the benefit of the online and iCourse students especially. However, the classroom students are welcome to watch all of the videos that we make during our classes. At the beginning of the class, I did go over some administrative issues and ideas and made some announcements, but you'll find everything that you need on Blackboard in the announcement page or the course information page. So I'm just going to get started right away on our lecture that we went over. We didn't get through the entire slide deck, so I'm just going to go as far as we got during the class on Wednesday, and we'll pick it up from there next time we meet. So this is an introductory kind of a definition of leadership type of presentation. It's very much an overview, very generic. It starts out with some classic definitions of leadership, distinguishes between management and leadership. And then we get into some examples of environmental leadership at both the individual and organizational levels at the end of the presentation. So let's roll. The first slide we have here is something that all of us need to practice every day in our lives, no matter where we are, whether it's at home or at school or in your organization where you work. These are all really good pieces of advice for people to improve their own image and character and gain more respect in their circle of friends and people that they influence. But first and foremost, on the top of the screen, is making sure you're always complimenting people and praising them and telling them why they're valuable to you as a friend or your organization as an employee. Always people like to hear that. I mean, you don't need to butter them up in an excessive way, but there are plenty of opportunities to recognize the good things people are doing and to de-emphasize the bad things. So you want to catch people doing things right and showing why they're worthy of, their action is worthy of their commitment, and encourage them to keep up the good work and to excel. Another kind of phrase that you may have heard, Covey, I believe, is the one, Stephen Covey, who came up with this, is leadership cannot be taught, but it can be learned. This is not necessarily true. This is Covey's view. That's his opinion. However, you will see that phrase in several leadership texts. And what that means is it goes back to the old expression, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. So that's a colloquial expression we use out here in the West. Essentially, what it means is you give people the tools and the resources that they need to succeed and to be great leaders, to become leaders, to improve their leadership skills. But it's really up to them as an individual to decide whether or not they want to act on the opportunity that you presented to them by sending them to classes, giving them an opportunity, for example, through a promotion, to show how they can be leaders. And so people have to choose to learn these things and to practice them and improve them constantly. There are very few people who are just born leaders, so to speak. It comes with practice and experience and time. And you constantly can improve your leadership characteristics as you go through your career. So, it depends on your point of view and your opinion on how you believe these things, but most people are not born leaders. The last one on the slide is about what I call the high-performance team. It's where you have a team with a lot of depth. Think of a championship sports team, for example, World Series winners, NBA champs, etc., Olympic champs. This is where every person on the team is just gelling with one another. They all know where they are on the court at the same time. They have this court sense. They, you know, it's like they have eyes in the back of their head when they're playing basketball, it seems, in a high-performance team. But it's the, you know, the same thing is true in with an office team or an academic team or you know, a field team that's charged with going out and getting a batch of samples or whatever it may be. You're going to have those who have their strengths on the team and those who the people that don't have as much in the way of you know, experience and skill and knowledge, but they're going to be constantly learning from one another. And everybody has their weaknesses, no matter what. Even the ones who are your best performers on the team, they may not be able to do it all. You shouldn't expect everybody on the team to be able to do it all. So you want to capitalize on the strengths of each person's abilities, and then you know, have the other ones who have stronger strengths or better strengths in the area of a weakness for another team member to step up and to fill in the gap, so to speak. So a high-performance team is where everybody is exhibiting chemistry with one another. This slide is going to be really hard to read because of the gray bar in it, but it's an incredibly huge survey. I believe they had about 54,000 some people surveyed for this thing. And it was just to get an idea of what workers especially saw in a leader. You know, what do they think are the characteristics of an effective leader? And I was pretty surprised to see the results here, because courage comes up over and over again in just about every leadership text that you would read. But that's the lowest one on this scale. From a survey of 54,000 people. Instead, the overwhelming highest characteristic, most often voted characteristic of an effective leader is integrity, followed quickly by communicator, people-focused, visionary, and caring. And so it shows, in my mind, you know, I think the number of 54,000 people makes it a very robust and believable, statistically significant survey. What this shows in my mind is that the characteristics that we look for in a person who is honest and with high integrity and shows that they're, you know, a generous and caring individual are going to be the most valuable towards seeing that the workforce respects you as a leader. So it's important to keep this in the back of your mind. I mean, there's no one magic formula for what makes an effective leader. This is just a compilation of some of the classic leadership texts. And here's another long list. This one is an older list by Roberts, and it's not ranked in terms of order of importance. But when I read the book, it was more emphasizing things like loyalty and courage in the first two up there, rather than the credibility and integrity side of things, although those kinds of words are also here in this list. If we pick out a few others that we didn't see on the previous list by Covey, you'll see things such as competitiveness and ambition and decisive. And so this list of leadership qualities, yeah, once again, it's from an older period of time in our history of studying leadership, but nonetheless, they've been identified over the years as having high value. You also see some of the things that we preach in our environmental classes about environmental protection, such as stewardship in there, and responsibility, you know, taking responsibility for protecting the environment. So there are opportunities to show your environmental leadership here. If you look at the leadership qualities, stewardship and responsibility, I think those go well with environmental leadership principles. Accountability is also another one I think that fits in nicely with the concept of environmental leadership that we talk about over and over again in this semester's class. Here's another list from Kuzes and Posner, which is more emphasizing the credibility side of things, but once again, it's not ranked. You'll see that people who are considered dependable, honest, inspiring, competent, intelligent, mature, they're the ones who are going to have the most credibility. And this book talks about the term credibility over and over again. That's the title of the book. And it emphasizes that as being the number one most important characteristic of admired leaders. And so, you know, in trying to define what is credibility, those words that I just said, especially honest, inspiring, competent, intelligent, are the ones that make a person be viewed as more credible in the eyes of whoever they're trying to influence or persuade. That's what leaders do. They influence and persuade. They're attempting to get people to participate and share their common vision. Not necessarily order people around, but to have the workforce inspired to do the same that the leader is trying to do. Some other terms that are on this set of characteristics that we may not have seen in some of the other slides before are imaginative. You also see determined. I think determined and tenacious have similar ringtones there in my mind. Also broad-minded, open-mindedness, not being stubborn or that in my mind being stubborn is the opposite of many of these things, especially things like broad-minded. A stubborn person, they have it in their head that it's got to be my way or the highway, and they're not willing to negotiate much, or they don't tolerate the viewpoints of others very well. So that's a really negative thing to be stubborn. You want to be as broad-minded and open-minded as possible wherever you are, no matter what you're doing. Imaginative, that gives the leader an opportunity to come up with new and creative ideas and to inspire others to come up with new and creative ideas that might take the workforce the next step forward, invent a new product, give it a competitive edge. So let's move on to another slide. This is from Covey again, Eighth Habit book, and he talks about the seven habits of highly effective people over and over again. There's a chapter on each of these in that book. Number one is being proactive. And this means the opposite, of course, is you don't want to be reactive, you want to be proactive. You're always trying to think ahead and choose based on your high principles and high values rather than on whim. You want to stick with your personal beliefs. Have you established your own vision, your own statement of who you are as an individual. You know yourself. You have a voice that is heard in many different ways every day on the job by your workforce. So choosing to speak in those terms all the time, and then also being visionary, having foresight to predict what might be coming around the next few weeks, the next few months, 5 years, 10 years down the road, to always be thinking ahead, having your priorities straight. Number three, we all get distracted by the kinds of things we would rather do than the ones that may be the most important. For example, watching the next episode of some sitcom on TV rather than open up the book and studying and reading the next chapter. I imagine some of you have probably found yourself doing that instead of keeping your eyes on the prize, the grade A at the end of the class. So you want to have your priorities straight. Same thing in the workforce. You know what the top goal is for your office or your organization, and you keep moving towards that every day as rapidly and as correctly as you possibly can. Four is think win-win. Now this one is an old time worn expression, a cliche even, but it's an ideal. And in reality, it's usually not win-win, it's a compromise. And some people come out thinking that they're ahead of the other at the end of the game, but if both people who are participants in a negotiation or a conflict resolution feel like they got something out of it at the end, and that during the process they were treated with mutual benefit and respect, and as a professional, as a human being, then it makes the final outcome, whether they won the battle, so to speak, or not, to be less painful, less harsh. And in environmental management, environmental leadership type of setting, we do see that common, because our profession is just rife with controversy. And there's also a heavy dependence on compliance with rules and regulations, laws, etc. And people oftentimes find themselves out of compliance, and they may be facing a fine or a penalty during a negotiation with a regulatory agency where they're going to be the loser, so to speak, in the end, because they'll end up paying a fine. But there is a way to work through those negotiations so that both parties feel like they resolved it in the best possible way for getting the job done. And it's really treating each other with mutual benefit and respect and professionalism throughout the process, whenever there is a conflict to resolve. But it's not really win-win. Seek first to understand, then be understood. And this implies that we all need to be excellent listeners. This means that you need to keep that open mind. You want to be careful of your body language when you're listening to somebody, so that you're not giving clues that you're losing interest, or that you don't respect what they're saying, or you think what they're saying is unwise or maybe even stupid. So don't do the eye roll while you're talking to people. You want to look them in the eye and listen carefully and smile as much as possible and come up with a response that shows that you did listen and understand what they said. And if you didn't quite comprehend it, or you can't agree with it, then ask for clarification, ask for more explanation, politely and professionally give your opposing point of view. But that's face-to-face human communication. That's the highest, richest form of communication that we can experience. And it's so tempting nowadays to use the cell phone, use the text messaging system, leaving messages, using emails, and we don't even want to pick up the phone and talk to each other on the phone anymore with a real phone conversation. So every time you deviate even a little bit from the face-to-face type of setting, you're losing something in that communication potential. So the richest form of communication, where the best opportunity for both people to be heard and understood, is face-to-face. And be careful also in your face-to-face conversations. For example, your cell phone goes off, your text messaging tone goes off, or whatever. Ignore it. Keep that conversation going. Listen and look at the person. Don't be tempted to stop the communication so that you can go do your cell phone thing. It's rude. It's rude. And another thing that I see people doing oftentimes in crowds, when there's a great opportunity for this face-to-face communication and networking to take place, maybe it's at a conference or a workshop or a seminar or something like that, even in the classroom. There are many, many distractions going on in a room with a lot of people and side conversations going on. If you're in the midst of a conversation with a colleague face-to-face and somebody walks behind and your eyes stray and you start following that person across the room with your eyes and trying to keep up a conversation with the person you were just talking to, you're losing them when you do that. So you want to stay focused on the person you're talking to. And you know, even though you see somebody else on the side of the room or down the hall or whatever who you know you have to talk to, you know, wait for another opportunity, another time, instead of ruining the moment. And having that richness of communication face-to-face and the opportunity to listen and understand and, you know, become a stronger friend with a person. If you're, you know, it's a person on your workforce, you want to establish that caring and human, you know, human connection with everybody, as many people as you can on your workforce, knowing their names and getting to know a little bit about them in their personal and family life. I mean, not by prying, but, you know, to show that you care about them as a human rather than just as another employee who's assigned to crank out widgets or reports or whatever it is they were hired to do. So I went on a tangent there about number five, but listening is very important. Synergizing means to take advantage of the strengths of everybody on the team and recognizing where those weaknesses are in some of those team members so that you capitalize on the strengths of each person and use those strengths to fill in the gaps, as I mentioned in another slide, where there are weaknesses on the part of another team member. So together as a collective whole, you make this high performance team. And that's a synergistic type of approach to building the high performance team. Last one on the list is sharpening the saw, which is an expression for keeping your mind sharp. But what I really like the most about Covey's book is that he goes way beyond just the physical and the competence of technical skill type of approach to keeping yourself sharp, and he goes into the emotional, mental, and spiritual discussion of what that means. So let's do a slide here that talks about that more. Covey calls it the four intelligences. So the first one is pretty obvious, and so is the second one, mental intelligence. But if you are in great physical condition, you're showing up to work every morning, once again, as the leaders need to be there at the office while their employees are there and in good shape and doing their job and inspiring people to come to work and be with them every day rather than being hard to find, hard to catch, hard to get a hold of. You want to constantly be seen as a vigorous and a smiling and engaged person in the office every day, or in the field team every day, or in the classroom, or whatever, wherever it is you're trying to assert your leadership. A person can only do that successfully if they're keeping themselves in good physical condition. We all know what's essential for that. Then the second one on the list there is mental intelligence. So doing a lot of professional development, continuing to educate yourself by reading, going back for more higher education courses, getting new certifications. In our degree program here, we afford our students the opportunity to get 40-hour HAZMOBR training, Department of Transportation hazardous materials training, and any number of advanced RCRA, Advanced Clean Water Act, and other types of technical courses, which we call professional development courses. And those are not required as part of your degree to get a four-year degree. But by the time you graduate, if you have, in addition to the diploma in environmental resource management, now you also have all these certifications, which employers value for on-the-job use. So you're honing your skills there intellectually and bringing more to the table than other students who are graduating from environmental science programs at other universities around the country. Ours does have this professional development enhancement that you can take advantage of while you're here. Also, knowing who you are, and that brings us more into the emotional intelligence and the term self-awareness. And this means that you know yourself, you know what drives you, you know what makes you tick, you know what motivates you, and you know where you need to go to get things done in terms of what is the prize at the end, the top goal, the highest priority, and you're able to stay focused and aware and on track towards that direction. And it takes self-regulation, self-control to do that. And it's also been, the term emotional intelligence has also been termed or coined emotional IQ. Some of you may have read about emotional IQ, but one of the most difficult things that people face is keeping their emotions under control, because we do get challenged every day by things that make us mad. I got cut off in freeway traffic on the way into the office today, or somebody made a rude remark on a phone call. Somebody made a rude statement in an email, and it's easy for your mind to react in a reactive way instead of a controlled way when something like that happens, by flinching, giving the dirty look, or firing off a nasty email right in response to another nasty one you just got. But you should not do that. But leaders need to show that they have great control over their emotions, even to the point of having a poker face when you're dealing with high stress, challenging, kind of a confrontational type situations. You want to show that you've got control over it. You're not going to stoop to their level by yelling back and getting angry in return, because that's unprofessional. And you lose credibility when you let that happen. It's important to always smile if you can, and if you can't, because it's really burning you up inside, then keep the poker face on when you're challenged with those kinds of situations, so that you don't show anger during a confrontation. Also on the list here are empathy and social skills. And so the term empathy means that you're able to put yourself in the shoes of others, and you may be dealing with a person who is going through grief, or is going through a very stressful situation on the workforce, and their job performance is suffering because of it. But try to put yourself in the shoes of that person and not take any kind of retaliatory or disciplinary action, but rather empathize with them and try to understand their situation, and see if you can find help to get them back or healed as fast as possible after the stressful event in their life. And all of us have these things in the workforce. You're always going to have people in the workforce who have a death in the family. There's divorce. There's a really sick kid, a really sick spouse. There's arguments going on in their family, maybe even domestic violence. There might be, substance abuse issues. And so there's a lot of things that individuals in the workforce face and bring to the office. And, the leader needs to, once again, empathize and try to help their employees to get over the bad times. We all know there's going to be good times and bad times in any office. We've got budget cuts from now and then, but then we also have boom times and new grants and new contracts and other times when the company or the organization gets a boost. And so being able to celebrate those things. And social skills, that's another thing that the leader needs to practice. So when you do have an opportunity to celebrate successes, arrange for the social celebratory session, and to constantly get out there and, you know, walk up and down the halls and in the be a presence in the workforce. You don't go hiding in your office. So those are all softer type of leadership practices that people have to learn over time by practice and experience. It just doesn't come overnight. The last one on the list is spiritual intelligence. And here is where the leader doesn't necessarily, shouldn't really be preaching any religious belief in the workforce. That's highly not recommended. But what I'm meaning by spiritual intelligence is that, you are a leader with high moral values, with high integrity. You're honest. You know who you are. You have have discovered your voice, and you express your voice, meaning that you have your underlying principled beliefs that are very strong, and they come out in your messages to the workforce on a constant basis, in the elevator, going up and down every day, on the stairways, and at the beginning of meetings, at the end of meetings, during lunch. You have plenty of opportunities to, in many different ways and with many different nuances, to constantly show the people on your workforce who you are as an individual. And I call it discovering your voice and showing your voice to your workforce. Spiritual intelligence, we can go on and on and on about that, but more than anything else, it's being a person of high integrity and a role model, and treating each other with respect and dignity, treating each other as you would expect them to treat you as human beings, and with a high degree of professionalism. Okay, so moving on to the next few slides here on management versus leadership. Some people do get these things mixed up or confused, but there are big distinctions between what's management and what's leadership. And the ideal leader will have good management skills and abilities, as well as excellent leadership skills and abilities, but it's not always true. You might have a leader who is really bad at planning and budgeting, and they just don't want to do that. They have delegated that to somebody else. They don't enjoy it, and so that's fine. But there has to be somebody on the workforce who does enjoy doing planning and budgeting, and there has to be somebody on the workforce who's good at it. And that way, you're once again capitalizing on the strengths of every team member. So the leader doesn't have to have all these traditional management skills of planning, organizing, budgeting, directing, controlling, etc. So management is more a structured, kind of results-oriented approach, where you have a plan with goals and objectives and metrics to keep everybody on track, and you have spreadsheets, and you're watching it, and you can go put posters on the wall with thermometers showing how close to the goal you are, or bar charts showing how close to each of these goals you are. And those are all good things. They're great reminders and communication tools for a workforce to have graphics like that around, and dashboard type reports that are easily accessible on their computers. But that's not leadership. That's just helping people stay focused and reminded of what the goals are. Leaders need to establish direction and make sure that people are aligning with what the goals are of the organization, and that the people who are deviating from that, need to get with the picture or go find another job, essentially. You can't always expect everybody, especially in a very large workforce. The department that I directed, Maricopa County Environmental Services Department, had about 350, 400 people, and there's going to be some who are disgruntled, or they don't like the job, they don't think they're getting paid enough, whatever the reasons are, they're not happy campers. So There's going to be some like that in every workforce, and it's important to bring out the best in everybody and highlight the positive. Once again, catch people doing things right and encourage them constantly and praise them constantly, even in times when there's not much money to go around for raises or whatever. There's been budget cuts, maybe even layoffs. So workforces go through change constantly, and it's an ongoing everyday effort to keep people aligned and moving in together as a team. So leaders have to find ways to do that. And, we go through this entire semester of excellent examples of environmental leaders, you'll see plenty of good examples of how they've done it, how they've been successful. A lot of success stories will be told during the rest of the semester by a cadre of top-notch environmental leaders that will be coming to speak to you. Leaders also have a job of motivating and inspiring the workforce or whatever their team is. It doesn't have to be a large team. A leader can be a leader for a small team, even just the leader of your family, the leader of the household you're living in. Leadership can be exhibited everywhere. But, traditionally think about it in terms of a workforce setting or an office setting. Here when we talk about it in a class, but think of leadership as something that you can practice and hone and improve everywhere you go and wherever your sphere of influence is. Another thing that is on this list is change and competitiveness. So the word change is important to recognize because change will happen no matter where you are or what kind of a situation you're in, whether it's a field team, an office team, an academic setting, even family setting. There's going to be changes, and there's whole management courses, whole leadership courses available to people if they want to become experts on this or study it on change management. So there's much been written on change management. We don't have time in this class to get into that much, but it's something to recognize that is a fact of life, a fact of the professional life especially, and there will be reorganizations. There will be changes of leaders. We have an election cycle every 2 years for the, what they call the off cycle or midterm elections, and then we have 4-year full-term elections. And whenever you see an election cycle go through, there's going to be a change in leadership and in the governmental structure with a trickle-down effect that can affect businesses, the universities. We had our budget cut here as a result of an election, and that was you're going to see change happening no matter where you are. There's going to be reorganizations, and the leader needs to show the positive in these changes to the workforce and to express where the opportunities are to get promotions, to jump in and fill gaps wherever there's a need to, and to point the opportunities out for people to make the best of that change that just occurred. Competitiveness is something that also is a fact of life when it comes to professional work, because we all know that a person who's highly successful, no matter what they do, cannot be mediocre. They have to be an excellent performer, and along with that comes ambition and competitiveness. And there's very few leaders in history who lack those characteristics of competitiveness and ambition. I don't ever want to imply that you should be overbearing in the way you express yourself and carry yourself in the workplace, because that turns people off a lot. You can even come across as being arrogant if you do this too much. So it's important to balance and blend and soften the edges of your competitive underlying personality or character or your ambitiousness. But true leaders have got it in them They've got that drive in them. It's pretty much inescapable. So that's enough on that slide. I think that, you know, Covey really hit the nail on the head, but with the four intelligences. How do leadership and management differ? Again, here there's another example of this is from a NIMS FEMA text, where managers are those who make sure that things are completed efficiently and effectively. Once again, especially if you're responding to something like an emergency, you've got to have strong management control. The leader has an opportunity to influence and motivate and move the group towards the common or shared goal. And the word influence is used here in this particular selection of words to show that, once again, there is an art to doing this, where you understand human psychology enough to be able to persuade and influence people to move in the direction that the group needs to be moving in for that common goal. And especially in the case of emergency decision making. The decision making styles here that we're going to talk about are, there's three most common ones on the list: autocratic, democratic, and laissez-faire. First one is democratic, where there's a heavy emphasis on opportunity for people to participate and get their points of view out. The leader oftentimes delegates, and there's a downside of it, and it can slow down the decision-making process because you're wanting to make sure everybody's voice is heard, you're keeping an open mind. There's constant opportunities for top-down and bottom-up communication. On the opposite end of the spectrum, I guess, well, that one's, I'm going to say that's the middle one. I should have reordered these things. The laissez-faire is probably the most loose and, kind of a anything goes matrix management type of approach to decision making, where there's large groups involved in decision making. The communications are not top down, bottom up. They're coming from every which direction. I call it matrix management. And there's a lot more delegation. The leader sometimes doesn't want to get engaged, and there's sometimes either no decision making or very slow decision making resulting from it. So that would be one end of the spectrum. And the once again, democratic decision making style is in the middle. Autocratic is the opposite of laissez-faire, where you have a top-down only, no delegation type of rapid decision making. And it's good for some situations, which we will now be talking about, but it's very common in the military. It's does stifle individual initiative, and it's to keep things moving fast and when it's necessary, and that's usually when there's some kind of an emergency that has to be taken care of. So you can have slow moving or fast moving or moderate moving types of emergencies. And in our practice of environmental management, environmental health and specialists, health and safety specialists, they oftentimes find themselves having to respond to spills and releases of hazardous chemicals on the job site. And so, there's no time for sitting around in a conference room giving everybody the laissez-faire opportunity to get their thoughts on the table. You want to know what you're going to do in advance and respond quickly. And this is when you need to have that autocratic decision-making going on. It's very relevant. We call it the on-scene commander or on-scene incident commander, who has the authority to make to give out the orders, to bark out the orders, and everybody who's a part of that response team needs to follow and not question the incident commander in order to ensure the quickest response. And there's a few examples given here. There's a fire breaking out, there's a hazmat release, you have terrorist activity going on, there's a fast-moving storm coming in. And you know, you need to make decisions like evacuate or shelter in place, or lock down buildings really quick in order to prevent loss of life. So on the next step down, the moderate emergency decision making, here's where you may have an opportunity to use more of a democratic decision making process, where you're seeking some consensus and you're always looking for more data, more information, so that you can make the best decision. So the hurricane coming in towards Florida right now, it's probably four, maybe 5 days out, and they're making plans for it now. They're doing emergency decision making using the consensus decision making approach and democratic decision making approach at this point in time. Now, when the storm makes landfall and there's flooding and threat to human life occurring, they'll be doing autocratic decision making to respond to whatever damage a storm like that is likely to bring. Then for the slowest type of emergency, where it's may take months and months to unwind, for example, a communicable disease outbreak that may go on for 2 or 3 months, or a biological weapon attack, which starts real slow with just a few people becoming ill, and then it will take months and months to get over something like that, a pandemic flu outbreak, and dealing with budget cuts that are going to have ripple effects throughout your organization for a long time to come. There's an opportunity there to practice the laissez-faire decision making, as long as you get a decision at the end. And that's the peril of laissez-faire, is that it's hard to see where the end is. You can see where the problem is starting to slowly begin, but where does it finally taper off and end? And so that's one of the downsides of laissez-faire, is that it's prone to non-decision making. And oftentimes you're dealing with a situation where you just don't have enough information or high quality information to call it and make the decision. You're just giving it a shot in the dark if the data are so scattered and without any direction or statistical significance. And it all happens in real life. All three of those versions of decision-making scenarios will happen as you go through your careers. Okay, so this is a slide that shows that the leader needs to have foresight and visionary thinking. So with a new product development, for example, there's a growth curve here, and it peaks out. The demand has been going up. New iPhone got released or whatever, and now everybody's got to have one. But guess what? Your competitor is trying to crank out an even better version of it, and you need to crank out an even better version than the new one your competitor is about to introduce. So while you're enjoying all this high rating profitability success, you've got to be inventing the next new product or the next new initiative, and getting it ready to introduce to market, so that you can just keep on repeating this over and over and over again. And that keeps your company going, or your whatever the service it is you're to be providing. Maybe it's an environmental consulting service, and you want to be able to anticipate the next emerging contaminant or the next regulatory development that might drive the success of the consulting business. Right now in the environmental practice, it's climate change. And also, if you're into water quality, it's the emerging contaminants of drinking water and these novel contaminants that we're finding in wastewater, antibiotics, pharmaceuticals, etc., slipping through and getting into the wastewater and then causing environmental damage, as well as eventually finding themselves in the drinking water. So I believe there's a lot of opportunities there for environmental professionals to be honing their skills to keep one step ahead by anticipating what's on the horizon from a regulatory point of view. So here is an example of how the leader should not penalize or be too harsh on people who make mistakes. They make mistakes themselves. Everybody makes mistakes. We're all human. And you want to learn from those mistakes and to make sure that things are done better the next time, but not punish people because they you want them to take risks, you want them to take chances to try something new. And until they're given the opportunity to stick their neck out and try something new without fear of being punished for something that may go wrong, you won't get that kind of creativity and productivity from your workforce. So you want to make sure that people feel comfortable about taking some chances, measured risks, not outlandish ones, of course. This goes back to the thoughts about emotional intelligence and spiritual intelligence and finding your voice and knowing who you are. And then that's very important for leaders to be certain about who they are and be able to articulate their beliefs strongly. And politicians try to do that all the time. That's how they're after our votes. They take a strong principled stance on some controversial issue. I'm pro this, I'm against that. And they're sometimes the politicians are one extreme to another and they won't compromise. And I don't recommend anybody behave like that in a professional work setting, but it's on the other hand, let's take an environmental management example point of view, you need to show the workforce that you strongly believe in environmental leadership, and you can exhibit that every day on the job. At the end of the lecture, we're going to talk about how to do that more, but the idea there is to constantly walk the talk, speak what your mind about how you feel the importance of environmental leadership is. For example, going beyond minimum compliance or being ready to immediately comply with a new rule or regulation. You start complying with it months or a year before the deadline for compliance comes up. You're planning for it and you're ahead of the game there. And you're prepping your workforce for the new environmental requirement. You're demonstrating to the regulatory agencies that that it's feasible for them to consider imposing a new technology, a new treatment technology. For example, inventing a new treatment technology and employing it to reduce your emissions. And then showing the regulatory agencies and others who have similar emissions that this can be done. It's feasible. It's technologically feasible. It's economically feasible. And that it should eventually become required. Thinking that way shows that you truly believe in being ahead of the curve when it comes to environmental performance. And, you've made that decision and you're going to show it every day on the job. So that can be something that you find is very important to you and you want to show your workforce, especially if you're leading a team of environmental managers around your factory or organization. And during the course of the semester, I'm going to have Greg Bopp coming in here, who's the top environmental leader for the entire world of Honeywell Aerospace facilities. And so he has as his employees on his team, environmental managers, some of whom are our alumni. And he practices this every day. He preaches it every day. He walks the talk, speaks the talk, and you'll hear him when he comes in the office. That's what drives him. That's his underlying daily message to the people. So that's his voice. He knows who he is. He knows what needs to get done in the organization. So once again, knowing yourself and showing that to everyone every day. I like the servant leadership message. Robert Greenleaf is the one who's written about this. And yeah, I don't know if anybody's heard of the Rotary Club, but they use that expression, service above self. That's their motto. And it's the same idea here with servant leadership, is you're always thinking about what's in the best interest of the organization, what's in the best interest of the community, what's in the best interest of your family, what's in the best interest of the world, not yourself. So you're constantly putting yourself in a secondary, tertiary level and others above you to advance the community, advance others rather than yourself. But you also gain as well, because everybody's happier, healthier, more on board with what the where the organization needs to be going as a result. And they call this leading with moral authority. And we are all humans. We all have our temptations. We all have our weaknesses. We're not saints. We're not perfect. And there are plenty of opportunities for people to do things that are not legal or not ethical or not professional. But a leader can't do that. A leader has to be a role model. A leader has to be perfect, pretty much, and a model citizen. And once a leader is caught in a scandal or committing a criminal act, then their moral authority is going to be undermined. Their credibility is going to be weakened. And depending on how bad it is, how much of a deviation from what's socially acceptable it is that the leader ends up falling prey to or making a mistake on, they may never come back from it. They may end up having to resign their position and go find something else to do. So it's extremely important for a person in a leadership position to be a model citizen, to be a role model, to show that they do have this high integrity. And you saw that in the earlier slides about how important it's viewed by the workforce. Another aspect of moral authority is if the leader starts cutting corners and going, well, maybe we can get away with letting our emissions go over the standard for just a few hours, as long as we've got a plan in place to bring those emissions back down quickly. No, you don't want to do that. You don't want to ever be implying that you would allow an environmental rule or regulation to be violated even in the slightest way, because as a leader, you want to keep your facility in compliance, way above compliance, with a margin of error, so that you don't ever have to be confronted with a tough decision like that. And you don't want to start that, you give them an inch, you take a mile type of way of thinking around the office or the factory or the place where you're working, because the minute you start cutting corners and saying, well, yeah, that's okay, we'll let that one slide. Maybe the next time it's going to be a bigger, we're going to let that one slide. And the next thing you know, it's the slippery slope down to total noncompliance. So following the rules and regulations of environmental compliance as an environmental leader is of utmost importance, and never showing that you're willing to even come close to a violation. You won't tolerate that as the person in charge of environmental management for your organization. Once again, because one thing can lead to another, and the people who work for you see you slipping and giving a little more towards the dark side, so to speak, and deviating from that ideal, kind of a model citizen approach, then they feel it's okay for them to also behave that way. I was going home from teaching class last night down the 202, and you know, I'm over in the right-hand lane with my cruise control on at about, it's a 65 zone. I think I had it set at 71, so bad. I was going over the speed limit, but people were flying by me, and all of a sudden somebody went zooming by me, probably, you know, 80, 90 miles an hour, and the guy that had been following me a few car lengths back, he decided, okay, that guy's going 80, I guess I can do it too, you know. So he pulls out and goes right down the highway fast, you know, let that guy get the ticket, I'll just tail him. And so that's the same way of thinking. If you, you know, start showing that you think it's all right to deviate a bit from the policies, the procedures, the laws, the regulations, then the rest of the workforce could follow you right into that nasty downward spiral. So moral authority is, you know, that's one example of how to preserve that in the workforce. And people see you as a servant, a servant leader. You're leading by example, and they're, you know, more likely to behave themselves. Okay, so here's a couple of quotes to kind of further you know, reinforce this message of what servant leadership is about. And Dag Hammarskjöld, who's a former UN secretary and great statesperson, said, "You have not done enough. You've never done enough, so long as it is still possible that you have something of value to contribute." So always think about what else you can do. "Life's most persistent and urgent question is, what are you doing for others?" Martin Luther King said in one of his famous speeches. So it's that kind of way of thinking. What's in the best interest of the organization? What's in the best interest of the community? Not what's in the best interest of yourself. Moving on to some environmental leadership definitions and trying to explain what is environmental leadership and you know, get away from that classic textbook leadership type stuff. Now we're moving into environmental leadership, and there really is no one standalone textbook on this that I'm aware of. It's a collection of writings, and all of the faculty here in our degree program talk this way. This is our voice. You know, this is the environmental and resource management degree program way of thinking. Every single one of the faculty here is in concert with it. We are aligned in trying to inspire and grow environmental leaders. We want all of you to be environmental leaders. And so a distinction can be made, though, when you think about environmental leadership, between the organization as an environmental leader or the individual as an environmental leader. And if you're not yet in a management position, if you're just starting out after graduating here, you still have plenty of opportunity to demonstrate your environmental leadership as an individual. And that's going to wear off on the people around you wherever you work and enhance your chance to be promoted and become a person in authority who can move the organization into an environmental leadership position. So they complement each other. They both make beneficial impacts. So here's a few examples of how an individual can show that they're environmental leader. First of all, having a keen knowledge base about environmental science, and you should be in a good position upon graduation from this degree program to show your aptitude and intellectual capability there. Then clearly articulating your personal commitment to environmental protection, you know, without going overboard and talking about it, you know, like you're a tree hugger, protester type person. You know, you want to keep it, you know, in a mindset that's, you know, reasonable within the framework of a sustainable economy. In other words, you know, make do things that are, you know, reasonable within the field of practice that you're working in. Don't go overboard with it on a daily basis. Show that you're practicing pollution prevention and reducing pollution wherever you can as an individual and within your sphere of influence. Got some examples of that coming up. You could promote sustainable use of natural resources, conserve energy, and reduce fuel consumption, and constantly look for the health and safety risks within the area you're working and fix those things. Always seeking opportunities to educate others on environmentally responsible practices and looking for new ways to reduce environmental impacts. So on the natural resource side of things, you know, not wasting water, not wasting paper, and conserving energy and fuel consumption. That's mostly electricity and the fuel we burn in our vehicles that we drive. So reducing your speed, buying vehicles that have higher gas mileage than others that are fuel hogs, for example, and then also using mass transit or alternate modes like bicycle and walking as much as you can, telecommuting or teleworking even. And then as far as your opportunities to educate others, you know, this is every day all the time, you know, during lunch, during, you know, social activities, you know, happy hour, meetings where you go, you have an opportunity to express your point of view to people about your concern about the environment and you know, explain some of the things that you're doing that maybe they would like to try too. Give them, show them that it's easy and, you know, not impractical. Maybe there's a little bit of sacrifice associated with it, like changing your lifestyle by, you know, using mass transit. That does take some extra planning and you know, effort to try to, you know, work that into your busy schedule, because it does take longer to use mass transit in most cases. But still, you can try that out and then show people in the workplace that it can be done, and there's advantages to it. You get a chance to relax, you get a chance to read, take a nap or whatever. There's lots of advantages in addition to the environmental benefits. Then, you know, we mentioned the fuel efficient vehicles. You can eat lower on the food chain. These are, once again, individual actions that people can do. And, you know, for me, that's a sacrifice, because I really do enjoy, you know, meat-based meals most of the time. I usually don't have meat in the morning for breakfast, but, you know, lunch and dinner, I'm looking forward to a good sandwich or, a casserole with some kind of meat in it. When I go home at night, my wife and I are trying to make food together that's lower on the food chain. We're eating more fish, we're, you know, eating more vegetarian type meals, sometimes with no chicken or meat, just egg-based protein or vegetable-based protein. We don't do this all the time, but, you know, more and more, for our evening meal, we're trying to do that. I confess, though, I haven't moved in this direction enough yet for my lunch, but we know that the higher on the food chain we eat, the more resources we are conserving, especially water, because it takes, you know, just millions of gallons of water to produce the livestock that we grow for food here in our country. Think about all the grains and the food that they have to be fed to get to a point where they're consumable by humans. That's a lot of water. And there's also a lot of other natural resources in the form of electricity and petroleum-based fuels to, you know, run the farm machinery, produce the fertilizers and all these things that add up, so that by the time you're eating red meat, the top of the food chain there, it's taken a lot of natural resources to put that food on the table for you. And then continuing to make sacrifices in the interest of the environment and showing that you practice what you preach to the workforce. So here's a few cartoons that depict what I was saying about individual environmental leadership. The first one is the husband is out there crawling in the street after some roadkill while his wife is in the cafe saying, since we moved to the country, William and I have gone totally green, living off the land and being total vegetarians. So he's like I am at lunch, you know, I'm trying to sneak away and get my meat for lunch. Because I know when I go home at night, I'm probably going to get a vegetarian meal. So this guy's actually going after a roadkill. Next one here says, he's walking down the street and there's a store selling water. And it says, their loss, your gain, Arctic iceberg water. So there was climate change up north, melted the icebergs and the glaciers. And now we get to drink it down here. So reducing water consumption is something we all can do every day. Gotta drink enough water to stay alive, though. I mean, but, you know, there's many, many ways to reduce water consumption. So here's another thing people can do, recycle waste. The cartoon is showing a sewage treatment plant in the background and a bar where people are sitting around drinking glasses of treated sewage. So they're recycling, right? And here's an example of how we can reduce consumption of goods. The fellow in the box is saying, best of all, it's made from 100% recycled materials. So we actually do have around Earth Day every year on our campus a demonstration of how, you know, shelters can be built and by out of cardboard boxes, and that people can strive for a simpler lifestyle and reduce their consumption of everything, all our natural resources. Here's a message to choose products having less impact. So they tried solar, they tried the wind energy at their house, and now we even have a little nuke reactor out back. Hey, you know, nuclear energy doesn't contribute to greenhouse gases, so what the heck? Here's being an environmental advocate even during a job interview, and you know, the HR person is saying and to the candidate, and most important, how large is your carbon footprint? So you might have an opportunity to express these views during a job interview. And that might make an impression nowadays, a lot more than it did just a few years ago, frankly. Especially if you're, you know, vying for an environmental type of job, it's always a good thing to show that you believe in you know, what you're going to be doing on the job every day. You think it's the right thing to do. We're just about to the point where I wrapped up the class because we ran out of time on Wednesday. We lost about a half an hour there at the beginning due to some technical issues, but I think maybe we'll just do one or two more slides and wrap it up. And then when we meet again next week, we'll pick it up so that everybody in the class, the face-to-face students and the online students, get the same content. I don't want to get too far ahead here in this recording. We also need to recognize as environmental managers, environmental leaders, that in order to be a strong organization, as an environmental leadership organization, you need to practice a few principles of organizational environmental leadership. And the first one on the list is having transparency and great stakeholder participation. And this is true all the time for especially government agencies that are managing public information. But if you're a private company, you want to get the good word out about the things you're doing that are environmental leadership oriented so that you can you know, show the community that you're a good corporate citizen and that you do truly believe in conservation, natural resource management, environmental protection, and going beyond compliance. You know, bringing around you a sphere of advisors who I call stakeholders in this case is an opportunity for you to make the best decisions that can lead to improve credibility, improve trust, improve reputation. It also can improve the morale of the workforce because, you know, they're your stakeholders too, and involving them in decision making throughout the The business practice day is important to them for their morale. They feel they may be able to shape and move the company to go in a certain way. And it also enhances the opportunity for achievement of the goals and mission for the organization. If you involve as many people as you can, whether they're your critics or your advocates, so you want to identify everybody that you have an influence on, that you could be helped by, that, or even who is a potential harm to you, and try to find out more about them, get to know them, and hopefully reduce that competitiveness, or try to strike some mutual agreement on where you do have commonalities. So bring your critics to the table as well. People who are visitors, clients, contractors, always the general public, your customers, their stakeholders, obviously, and government agencies have an even broader list of stakeholders because they have a responsibility to be transparent. They're managing public information that taxpayers have paid for, and the general public has a right to it. Now, with the exception of things like criminal investigations, or homeland security type stuff, there are types of government information that legitimately have been classified as confidential. But for the most part, if it's information gathering about environmental releases, pursuant to EPCRA, for example, most of that is public information, and the government agency needs to work with everyone to make it available. So I think this is about as far as we got in the class, and I think it would be good just to wrap it up about here. I wish that we had an opportunity for questions and answers and discussion, but unfortunately this is just a recording, so I invite those of you who are watching it to number one, participate in the discussion board question that I post to revolve around what the recording says, but also to feel free to send me an email, phone call, talk to me in class about anything that I said that you would like to have clarification on. I remember I said earlier in the lecture that it's important for the opportunity for rich communication, and the best communication is face-to-face. So I always encourage students to come and see me in my office or before and after class, and so that we have an opportunity to meet and see each other. Thank you again for your attention.